Send your rain to your people. Send your rain, O Lord. 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 Send your rain to your people. Send your rain, O Lord. Send your rain, O Lord. Send your rain. Bring your kingdom.
Soften our hearts.
Soften our hearts, pour out your spirit, fill us anew, let your rain come. Soften our hearts, pour out your spirit, fill us anew, let your rain come. May your kingdom come, and your will be done on the earth. Your rain come, soften our hearts, pour out your spirit, fill us anew, let your rain come. Send your rain, O Lord, send your rain, O Lord, send your rain.
Good morning, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming out. Glad you're here to be with us. I am so glad to be back from vacation last week. Really missed you guys and missed being here and just glad to be back. And if you're a guest today, thank you for being here. We're glad you've come out to be with us today. Hey, I heard some good news. I heard that it's a tax-free weekend in Huntsville, so that means there's no implications for your contributions today. You can just double up on those. And it'll be great. So good news to start with. There's a card in the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and put it in the collection plate when it passes a little bit later on in the service. If you have a prayer request, please indicate that, and we will begin bending the knee on those prayer requests tomorrow morning, first thing. We'll start praying about that all week long. So you can fill that out and put that in the collection plate a little bit later on. If you are visiting, hey, we're really glad you're here. And I have a theory. It's a sense, maybe even more than that, maybe it's a conviction, that when people come to visit with us here, there are all kinds of reasons, but behind those reasons, I think God is there. I think God's Spirit is there, in fact. I think people come here because somebody invited them, or because they're looking for a church home, or because they have a need, but really, I think God is arranging the parts of the body just as He wants them to be. And it may be that if you're visiting today, it's because somebody here has been given a spiritual gift that would meet a need that you have. Somebody here has been through what you're going through, and they can help you with it. They have a gift that can meet a need in your life. But I also think it's possible that if you're here, it's because this church has a need that you can help with, and God's Spirit has brought you here to bless us. I think that's a possibility and one that you should consider. Heard a story kind of like that this week, and it sounds, well, let me put it this way. We don't believe in magic, but we do believe in mystery. Karin, can you come on up here? This past week, Shannon Bridges, who's on our staff, told a story in our staff meeting that was so compelling, and it gives me chill bumps now when I think about it. I wanted you to hear it because it's about how God's Spirit works in people's lives in ways that we just, well, we're surprised by them. Shannon?
So last week, after class, I made my way in to my seat, and I know none of you can identify with this at all. None of you have this problem, but I sometimes make my way in and find my seat, and I'm pretty oblivious to everybody else. Like, I'll say hi to the same four people, right, that are sitting right around me, but I don't always pay attention, don't always look up, don't always see everybody else. So last Sunday, I did the same. I came in and I sat on the second row there, but I turned around and looked over my shoulder and saw Norma Perry. And she had on the most beautiful blue blouse. She just looked lovely. And I sat there and thought, I'm going to have to go tell Norma how beautiful she looks this morning. So I got myself up and walked halfway down the middle aisle. And Norma was talking to someone else. And so I was just kind of standing there awkwardly by myself, waiting for her to finish. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw a girl making her way down the center aisle. So I looked over, and I was like, hey, I'm Shannon. I don't think we've met. And she says, hi, I'm Karen, and I'm visiting. I was like, well, it is so, I'm really, really glad that you're here. Hey, Karen, where are you going to sit? She was like, I don't know. I said, well, do you want to come sit with me? And she said, okay. So we stood there together, and we told Norma how great she looked, because she did. And then Karen and I start walking back down the center aisle, which is when Karen realized that I sit on the second row with the praise team, right? I'm like, welcome to the praise team, Karen. So we did. We worshiped together. And then after church, I was like, hey, Karen, what are you doing for lunch? She was like, yeah, I have no idea. I was like, well, some of us go to, you want to go to lunch? She's like, sure. So she came to lunch with us, and we had a really great, interesting talk. She told me that she lives in the Monrovia Harvest area. That's where she's from. And I said, Karen, if you're living in Monrovia and Harvest, like, how did we score you, right? Like, how are you visiting at Twickenham? And she said, that's an interesting story. I went to college in California, and one Sunday, I was sitting at my little church, and the preacher walks down the center aisle to speak to a visitor that's sitting behind her. And she hears the preacher introduce himself. Hi, good to have you. What's your name? Where are you from? And the visitor says, hi, my name's Tom McKee. I'm from Huntsville, Alabama. And the preacher's like, hey, Tom, it is good to have you. And Tom says, I'm an elder at Twickenham. So Karen perks up, right? She's like, hey, I'm from Huntsville too, and I'm finishing college, and then I'll be moving back. And Tom says, you ought to give us a try. Like, if you don't know where you're going to go to church, you ought to see what's going on at Twickenham.
So I did. Hey, everyone. I'm Karen. And I've been visiting here for a few weeks with my boyfriend, Garrett. And I've gotten to know a few people. I'm very grateful for that. But I hadn't mustered up the courage yet to introduce myself to anyone else. And I really expected last Sunday to be a very lonely Sunday because Garrett couldn't be there with me. But instead, the Holy Spirit just totally blew me away. Shannon wasn't the only person to say hi to me that day, even though I think she might have been the loudest. when I walked into the adult class and sat down, and Dan Beasley introduced himself to me and asked about who I was. And Vicky and Barry Johnson sat down next to me and talked to me the whole class and asked who I was and just wanted to know about me. And it was actually Barry who suggested that I go up the stairs in the back to the auditorium instead of the side ones that I was going to take. And I know without a doubt that if he hadn't done that, I would not have been walking down this aisle at the exact time that Shannon was walking up it. And then, of course, there's all the people that I met because of Shannon at lunch and so forth. You might be wondering, like, why does this matter? This sounds like a great story. It sounds like you had a great Sunday last week. What does this have to do with the Holy Spirit? Well, I said a prayer the night before. I said to God, God, I really like this place. I really think it could be the place for us. But Lord, and I know I've only been going here a few weeks, but I'm really in need of friendship, and I'm really craving community, and I'm not brave enough to go out and get it. God, if you could just tell someone to say hi to me, that would be great. You see, the Lord, the Holy Spirit doesn't just give. He gives abundantly. He didn't just tell someone to say hi. He overwhelmed me with hi's last week. The Holy Spirit may be telling you to do something that seems really small and insignificant, something that doesn't appear to affect anyone else, like going up and telling someone that they look nice that day. But what you think is small, God can use to mean the world to someone else. It did to me. Thank you, Carl. Give her a hand.
Please. Obviously, we're talking about the Holy Spirit today, and I'd like for us to begin with a reading together as we affirm our faith. And just to urge you, if you see somebody, you have no idea that they may be so blessed if you just walk up and say hi. Let's do this together, shall we? We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere, the giver and renewer of life. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to serve the church and the world. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere, the giver and renewer of life. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all people to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in the church and in the culture, to hear voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere, the giver and renewer of life. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives. We rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Let's praise Him together.
I stand to praise you, but I fall to my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak. Light the fire. Oh.
Speaks to us from Galatians 5, from the message this morning. But what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others, exuberance about life, serenity. We develop a willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely.
Legalism is helpless in bringing this about. It only gets in the way. Among those who belong to Christ, everything connected with getting our own way and mindlessly responding to what everyone else calls necessities is killed off for good, crucified.
Since this is the kind of life we have chosen, the life of the Spirit, let us make sure that we do not just hold it as an idea in our heads or a sentiment in our hearts, but work out its implications in every detail of our lives. That means we will not compare ourselves with each other as if one of us were better and another worse. We have far more interesting things to do with our lives. Each of us is an original.
Let's take our offering. I praise you, Lord, for who you are and all the mighty things you've done. My soul, you made me whole. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. When I was lost and deep in sin, you sent your Holy Spirit. I praise you, Lord, for who you are and all the mighty things you've done. You saved my soul, you made me whole. I praise you, Lord, I praise you, Lord. Save my soul, you made me whole. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord.
Have you ever had an experience of reading this book, and you read a familiar passage that you've read 10, 50, 100 times before, and yet you see something new. Do you know this experience? This happened to me this week with the scripture that we're about to read. Have you ever asked why? Do you think it's because we have different experiences? Now, you read it when you're single, and it means one thing. You read it when you're married, it reads something different. You read it when you have kids, it's really different. And that's one reason. I think another reason comes from Romans 12, too, that we're being constantly transformed into the image of our Creator by the renewing of our minds. But there's a third. I believe it is the Holy Spirit teaching us what we need to hear when we read God's Word. Very quickly, in the Gospel of John, verse 26 of chapter 14, "But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything that I have said to you." So this week, I read the following verse, and I learned. Let's go together. Matthew chapter 27, verses 45 to 50. "From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' When some of those standing there, they heard this, they said, 'He's calling Elijah.' Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a stick, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, 'Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him.' And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit." This is the very spirit that in chapter 3 of Matthew's gospel descended from heaven as a dove. The Holy Spirit that equipped Jesus as the fully human man, the fully divine human man, for the next 3 years of his ministry. This Holy Spirit equipped Jesus to death on a cross, to obedience to his Father. This ceremony we are about to partake in is in remembrance of our Savior, who was obedient to his Father, obedient unto death. Would you please bow with me? Father God, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus. Thank you for being obedient to your Father. Holy Spirit, thank you for teaching and equipping us with what we need to know. As we partake of this bread, Lord Jesus, it reminds us of your body that was pierced and broken for our transgressions, and that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We ask you to bless the partaking of this bread as we remember your body. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son.
So why in all the times that I've read Matthew's gospel had I not seen Jesus gave up his spirit? It was a lesson the Holy Spirit taught me this week, that the Holy Spirit of God indwells each and every one of us and equips us for the work for this kingdom. And it existed in our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus, as well as did God. This triune Godhead exists for all time and exists in each of us. Let's pray over Jesus' blood. Father God, we come to you again. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for shedding your precious blood for us. We know that your blood ushers in a new covenant, that we are no longer bound by the Mosaic law of sin and death, but the curtain was torn top to bottom, initiating a new covenant of grace and eternal life with you. We ask you to bless this fruit of the vine as we partake of it, to remember this covenant and remember your blood shed for our sins. It is through Jesus we humbly pray. Amen.
Spirit, rain down, rain.
Our God.
Hey, couple of housekeeping things here real quick. Number one, if you haven't taken the survey yet, what is wrong with you? All right? This week, would you go to the email, click the link, go online, and it'll take you 20 minutes or so. Please take that. We've got about half of the folks that we've expected to take it. So it's a good representation, but we would like to get more. So go online, take that survey. That's really going to help us figure out what classes and sermon series will best meet the discipleship needs in our church. So this week, please go do that. Second item of housekeeping, Ethan, I forgot the word, so sorry. Teenagers give me a word every week to work into the sermon, and then he gave it to me, and the first one he gave me, I said no, not that word. Okay, the second one, I just forgot, so we'll worry about that one next week. Okay, I want you to think back to your college experience for a second, okay? Mine was this way, asking good questions was not the most important thing in my undergraduate training. In fact, getting the right answers was what was paramount. Now, whether that's the message the professors intended or not, that's what I embraced. Being right was the most important thing. And since getting the right answer was the overriding concern, my definition of unity was pretty narrow. Unity happened when everybody arrived at the same conclusion. If being right was essential, then the only pathway to unity was for everyone to agree on virtually everything. One of the problems was we could never agree on which things to agree on. So I remember very clearly the moment when that framework came crashing down, like the walls of Jericho. Every year, our university held a Bible lectureship that was a week-long seminar led by biblical experts from all over the world. One evening, I attended a lecture featuring two highly credentialed Bible scholars, and they were going to debate the Holy Spirit. And both of these, the third person of the Trinity, we've been singing about that all morning. So both of these guys were nothing less than first-rate biblical scholars, lots of letters after their names. The first guy began to speak, and he affirmed that the Holy Spirit worked only through Scripture. He denied that there was any kind of personal indwelling of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit worked within the heart of each individual believer to guide and direct. And he just denied all of that and affirmed that the Spirit only worked through Scripture. And when he finished his presentation, I thought that was the most sensible thing I had ever heard. How could anybody reach a different conclusion? And then the other guy spoke. And he affirmed that the Holy Spirit worked directly in the heart of the individual believer, that the Holy Spirit was there to shape and guide and mold and influence and do all kinds of things. And when he finished his presentation, I thought it was the most sensible thing I'd ever heard. How could anybody reach a different conclusion? But then the most confusing thing happened that night. When the session was over, those two men, unscripted, unrehearsed, met each other in the center of the stage and embraced. They hugged each other. They shook hands. They spoke at length to one another, and it was clear they held each other. I'm sitting in the balcony. I couldn't hear a thing they were saying, but it was obvious that they just held each other in the highest esteem and that they loved each other like brothers. So, you ever been to a movie where after it's over, you're just so overwhelmed, you just sit there even after the screen credits roll, and you sit there until they finally come up and say, excuse me, sir, you're going to have to leave, right? So I'm sitting in the balcony, just blown away by all of this, and I had two thoughts. The first thought was, could it be that questions are not only more intriguing, but often even more instructive than answers? That never occurred to me. And then the second thought I had was, my definition of unity has been all wrong. I've not been pursuing unity with other Christians. I've been pursuing uniformity. And if those two were animals, they'd be in different parts of the zoo. They are nothing alike. I really hope that you are further along than I was because this morning we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And I'm pretty certain that we are not all going to come to the same conclusions. And I'm confident that we'll have more questions than answers when we're done. But I have prayed, and I believe God will answer this prayer affirmatively, that we will be unified in our love for one another no matter what. We're in a series called Gifted, Graced to Work. And we've been talking about the spiritual gifts that God gives to every believer. By gifts, I mean abilities, aptitudes, talents, things that you can do that come from God and that God wants you to use to bless the lives of other people and to bring glory to Him. God wants you to use your gifts to serve others. That's what we mean by spiritual gifts. And we've talked a lot about those spiritual gifts, but one thing that we haven't talked about is the giver, the Spirit. Now, you need to know right up front that there is no way that we're going to come close to saying all that can be said or needs to be said about the Holy Spirit. What we're going to do this morning is sort of like walking past the fragrance aisle in the department store, right, where they hand you that little scratch and sniff card. You just get kind of a whiff of the Spirit. And for you ladies, it's like going to Home Depot and they give you the chance to use a nuclear-powered drill, right? You can't take it home, but you get to use it, right? That's all we're going to be doing this morning, just a little kick in the tires and test drive and getting a whiff of. And what I pray is that it raises questions. Our conversation this morning raises questions for you and piques your interest and causes you to go into Scripture more deeply, deeper. To learn more about God's Spirit. That's what I hope. I want to tell you four things about the Spirit this morning. The most important thing you can know about the Spirit is who He is. And He is God. He's not an idea. The Spirit is not a super angel. He's not a ghost. He's not a phantom. He's not a little S Spirit. The capital S Spirit is nothing less than God. He is as much God as Jesus Christ is God, as God the Father is God. In fact, He makes up one part of what we call the Holy Trinity, the God in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, which is a thing that we're not going to talk about today because that really takes a long time, and I have no idea. It's just it's an incredible mystery. But He is equal to God the Father and God the Son. In fact, the Holy Spirit shares in God's divine attributes, the things that are true of God and not true of anything else. For example, the Spirit is called the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is called the Eternal Spirit. And like God the Father, the Holy Spirit is omnipresent. That is, He is everywhere all the time. Psalm 139 verse 7 asks, "Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" It's a rhetorical question. And the answer is nowhere, because the Spirit is everywhere. The Spirit was even present at creation. Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, "Now the earth was formless and empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters." The Spirit's right there at the beginning. The Spirit wasn't just present at creation. He is involved in creating you. Job 33 verse 4 says, "The Spirit of God has made me. The breath of the Almighty gives me life." I can't ever read that passage. "The Spirit of God has made me." I can't ever read that without feeling a lot of conviction about how many babies are aborted every year in our country. The Spirit of God has made them. Who are we to destroy them? The Spirit is God. There's an interesting passage in Acts 5 that demonstrates how the early church embraced this doctrine, this teaching, from the very beginning. There was a man named Ananias, and with his wife Sapphira, they conspired to lie about a contribution they made to church. They said that they sold a piece of land for X amount of dollars and that we gave X amount of dollars, the whole sum, and they hadn't. And they didn't have to give it all, but they lied about it. And so in Acts chapter 5, verse 3, Peter confronts Ananias, and here's what he says. Pay attention to what he says. He says, "How is it, Ananias, that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit?" One verse later in verse 4, Peter says, "You have not lied to men, but to God." In Peter's mind, the Holy Spirit and God were the same. Now, the implications of this are huge. The idea that the Spirit is God, the implications are huge. In our fellowship, in our tribe, in the churches of Christ, we've not always honored God the Spirit as we should. In some ways, our Trinity was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Scriptures. But we're not alone in that. The only group that I know that has not done that would be the Pentecostals, and yet sometimes they overdo the Holy Spirit. They too much focus on the Holy Spirit, and I would think the Spirit doesn't like that because his whole thing is to point to Jesus. But in our fellowship, we've neglected the Spirit. Let me read you something from Francis Chan in his book, Forgotten God. He confronts all of us, not just those of us in the Church of Christ, but all of us. He writes, "While no evangelical," and that's you and me and the Baptists and the Methodists and the Presbyterians, that's all of us, "while no evangelical would deny the Spirit's existence, I'm willing to bet there are millions of churchgoers across America who cannot confidently say they have experienced His presence or action in their lives over the past year, and many of us do not believe we can." And then he adds this, look at this, "The benchmark of success in church services has become more about," I mean, when I read this, it left a mark. "The benchmark of success in church service has become more about attendance than the movement of the Spirit. The entertainment model of church has filled our churches with self-focused consumers rather than self-sacrificing servants attuned to the Holy Spirit." I had to put ice on my eye after I read that. That one left a mark. Relegating the Holy Spirit to a lower position than God Himself, or elevating anything above Him, results in stagnant churches and stunted growth. So the first thing I want you to grasp is that the Holy Spirit is God. Second, the Spirit is our guide. He's our guide. Now, that automatically is going to make some of us nervous. And I'll tell you, I've moved a lot on this one. That used to really make me nervous. Somebody would say, "Well, the Holy Spirit guided me." I'd go, whoa, what's going on here? I got real nervous about that. And really, I shouldn't be nervous about that. I became unconcerned about the idea of the Holy Spirit being our guide when I embraced this idea that the Holy Spirit is God. We don't have any problem with God being our guide, do we? I mean, don't we sing, "Guide me, O thou great Jehovah," right? We sing that sometimes. We like the idea of God being the guide. And we don't have any problem with Jesus being our guide. That whole, remember back in the 90s, that whole WWJD bracelet thing? What would Jesus do? That was all about follow Jesus. Let Jesus be your guide. Let Jesus lead you. Do what Jesus would do. So we don't have a problem with God being our guide or Jesus being our guide. If the Spirit is God, then we should be surprised if He doesn't guide us. Look at Psalm 143, verse 10. This is actually a prayer for Spirit guidance. "Teach me to do Your will, for You are my God. May Your good Spirit lead me on level ground." Paul was apparently very comfortable with the idea of the Holy Spirit being a guide. Galatians chapter 5, verse 18, he wrote, "But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under law." So it's not a thing to be afraid of, okay? It's nothing to be afraid of here. The big question is, how does the Spirit guide us? So let's look at that for just a second. The Spirit's primary means of guidance is through Scripture. Listen to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, watch this. "We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable. Don't get hung up on the word prophetic. We always think, oh, that means predicting the future. Prophetic or prophecy is proclaiming the will of God. Sometimes it means predicting the future, but most of the time it's just proclaiming the will of God. So Peter is saying we have the prophetic message, and he's talking about Scripture, which we'll see in the next verse. We have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and I love this, you would do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Verse 20, above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. These guys weren't just making this stuff up. For prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God. Read these last few sentences with me. They spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is his book. 40 different people over a period of 400 or so years wrote it, a couple of different languages, but this is the Holy Spirit's document. Scripture, the Bible, is the Spirit's primary means of guidance. That means that the Spirit will never guide, prompt, lead, or in any other way move you to do something that violates his clear teaching in Scripture. If you feel like you're being led to do something, but that something goes against the grain of Scripture, it's not from the Holy Spirit. Can I just be blunt? If you feel like the Spirit is guiding you to divorce your spouse and marry your boyfriend or girlfriend, no, he is not guiding you to do that. He will never guide you into an action that contradicts the very Scripture he authored. But what about those other issues or concerns that are not directly addressed in Scripture and don't really have a moral or ethical thing at stake there? Does the Scripture offer any guidance? Yes. But I think we have to be really careful here. I'm just going to speak for me, okay? You can decide whether this applies to you. I have learned through bitter experience not to believe everything I think. I have learned, okay, let that roll around. I have learned to be really suspicious of me. Because there have been times when I was so certain that a course of action that I wanted to take was right, and that direction that I had in mind was totally a God thing, and that the Spirit was just all over it and going to bless it, and it was a train wreck. Because it wasn't the Holy Spirit I was listening to, it was the Jody Spirit I was listening to. So I've learned to be really suspicious of me. How can you tell the difference between true Spirit guidance and just something you just want to do? Well, let me give you three ideas to kick around for a little bit. First, I think you and I have to realize that sometimes what you want, what I want, what the Spirit wants are not going to be the same thing. What we want, what the Spirit wants are not the same thing. Paul said, this is Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. My heart's desires and the Spirit's direction are not always going to be in harmony, and I need to realize that. The truth is, when you look at Scripture, what you find is that the Spirit often leads people into places to do things that they don't want to go, and to do things that they don't want to do. He even did that with Jesus. Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. Okay, I can just about guarantee you nobody wants to go to the desert for 40 days with no food. Nobody wants to go to the desert for 40 days with no food to face the devil. But that's exactly where the Spirit led Jesus. Acts chapter 16, Paul really wanted to go into Asia to preach the gospel. Okay, that sounds like a really godly thing to me. Who would not want Paul to go into Asia to preach the gospel? He's a great preacher. They didn't know about Jesus. Sounds like it's a God thing to me. But the Spirit said no. So Paul goes, all right, I'll go to Bithynia. They don't know Jesus in Bithynia. I'll go to Bithynia and preach. And in Acts chapter 16, I think it's verse 7, says the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them. Why is it that we think that the Spirit is always going to lead us to do fun things and happy things and things that we already want to do and things that are joyful and just... Or when we look at Scripture, what we realize is that Spirit often leads people in exactly the opposite direction. I've had preaching buddies, and this is hilarious. I've had preaching buddies tell me that they were just certain that God's Spirit was calling them to a new church. God's calling me to a new church. God's Spirit is, I feel the Spirit moving me to go to this new church. And the thing that was always funny to me is that the Spirit always seemed to lead those guys to bigger churches with higher paying salaries and really nice benefit packages and a bass boat. That's what the Spirit always led them to. First thing, you need to be suspicious of you. If the direction you think is from the Spirit, if it's something that you really, really wanted to do anyway, you should probably question that. Second, you need to spend some time in prayer. And I don't mean an hour or a day. I mean weeks. You need to spend an enormous amount of time talking to God. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24 is a great guidance prayer. Search me, God. Know my heart. Test me. Know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and then lead me in the way everlasting. Just get on your knees, get on your face, and ask God to ruthlessly comb through your motives and remove anything that even smells like self. I'm saying that the way you tell the difference between doing a thing you just want to do and baptizing it as if it's from the Holy Spirit and knowing what real Holy Spirit guidance looks like is prayer. You get on your knees, on your face, and ask God to comb through your motives and remove self. Third, how can you tell the difference between Spirit guidance and then attributing to the Spirit stuff you already want to do? Take it to the church. Take it to the church. Ask, if you're a brother, ask several godly brothers. If you're a sister, ask several godly sisters to pray with you. Lay out your sense of what the Spirit is calling you to do, what you feel like the Spirit is calling you to do, and then humble yourself enough to listen to their response. Acts chapter 13, Paul and Barnabas got really clear direction from the Spirit as the church was worshiping and praying and fasting. God sometimes speaks to us through other people. We need to be humble enough to listen to that. Okay, the Spirit is God. The Spirit is our guide. And then third, the Spirit is our gardener. Galatians chapter 5, 23 through 23. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Could you use some more of that for your marriage? Could you use some more love in how you relate to your parents? Could you use some of that for how you relate to some other family members? Fruit of the Spirit cultivates, the Spirit gardens love out of our hearts. Joy. Could you use more joy? Peace. How about forbearance? Forbearance is what it takes to put up with people who are hard to deal with. That's forbearance is what you use when you deal with hard to deal with people. I bet you could use some of that at work. I know I could, all right? Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Could anybody in the room use some self-control? The Spirit is the gardener of God. He cultivates the very nature of Jesus in our lives. And here's why that's important. First, in the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul writes to a church that is hyper-blessed with spiritual gifts. The church in Corinth, they were just swarming with spiritual gifts. They had more spiritual gift than there are streets named Peachtree in Atlanta. They're just all over the place. But instead of using those gifts to bless others and glorify God, the Christians in Corinth were using those gifts to prove how much better they were than each other. It was a church full of people who were competing against each other, and their spiritual gifts was how they were keeping score. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul writes to them. And the first thing he says is, look, all of those gifts come from the same Spirit, okay? So the points don't count. And then he reminds them that every gift is important, that there are no unimportant gifts, that the church is like a body, and every member is a valued part of that body. None of you is the appendix. And at the end of chapter 12, the very last verse in chapter 12, Paul says, let me show you the most excellent way. And then he gets into chapter 13, which we call the love chapter. Love is one of the fruit of the Spirit. Love is one of the things that the gardener of God, the Holy Spirit, raises up in our lives. And Paul says this, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, if I have the gift of prophecy and can understand all mysteries, if I have a faith that can move mountains, and I'm blessed, so blessed with the gift of generosity that I give everything I have to the poor, even if I surrender my body to the flames as a martyr and don't have this one fruit, the gardener of God, the Holy Spirit produces in my life, if I don't have love, it's worthless. What I think Paul means is that without the fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit are useless and maybe even dangerous. That's why you and I need the Spirit to be the gardener of our souls. His work to cultivate in us the nature of Christ is what keeps our gifts from becoming useless at best and dangerous at worst. Okay, one last thing. Spirit is God, the Spirit is guide, the Spirit is the gardener, and the Spirit is not just the giver, He is the gift. He is the gift. In Acts chapter 2, Luke, the author of the book of Acts, tells the story of the first sermon preached after the resurrection of Jesus. Peter is the preacher. And in the audience are people who have either witnessed or heard eyewitness testimony about the miracles of Jesus and His teaching, His trial, and His crucifixion. In fact, some of them are the very ones who called for Jesus to be crucified. Peter confronts them with the truth of who Jesus was, that He was exactly who He claimed to be, the Son of God, and proves to them that He was raised from the dead. Now I want you to try to imagine what that moment was like for those people, how awful that moment must have been. You thought you were right. You thought this Jesus guy was at best a fake. And so when the crowd started shouting, "Crucify," you joined right in. And now you realize that you had a hand in driving the nails through the wrists of the Son of God. You killed the Son of God, and He's back. But instead of warning you that Jesus is going to retaliate, Peter, in this first sermon, just calls on you to repent, to change your mind and the direction of your life. Instead of telling you that Jesus has come to dish out some payback, Peter tells you, I just called you to be baptized, to go through this ritual where you reenact the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. And instead of getting even, Peter tells you that Jesus is going to give you a gift. You killed Him, but He not only forgives, but He gives you something you need. Acts chapter 2, 37, 30 through 39. When the people heard this, all Peter's sermon about who Jesus was, they were cut to the heart. They said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what do we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift, the Holy Spirit." You might think that was just for them, right? Peter said, "This promise is for you and your children and all who are far off, all whom the Lord our God will call." Amazing. Talk about grace. God doesn't just give us the gifts of the Spirit, He gives us the Spirit as a gift. Lincoln, come on up. Can I get our elders to go ahead and take their places, please, around the room? We're going to do something a little bit different this morning. Are you guys coming up too, or are you guys staying here? Yeah, I think you are. You are now. So we're going to do something a little bit different this morning. I want to give you a chance to respond to our teaching this morning, our singing, the Lord's Supper, the scriptures that we've heard. And I've asked our elders and their wives to kind of stand around the room. I'll be here unless I need to go talk to somebody for prayer. And what I want to make available to you is the opportunity to respond to whatever the Spirit is leading you to do this morning. Maybe you need some prayer this morning. There may be something going on in your life, a struggle, a concern, a fear, a burden, and you need somebody just to speak God's word into that, to hear your concern and pray over you. You can go to any of our elders and their wives, and they'll pray with you. They will. It may be that you know for a fact, okay, and I don't know what it is, but you know it and God knows it. Maybe nobody else but you and God knows this. There's something in your life that you know it's got no business being there. You know, you're not a Bible scholar. You don't need to be one to know that whatever this habit or this thing in your life is does not belong there. It's totally not what God wants for you. It's not even what you want for you, and yet you're kind of trapped in it. You know, you could tell us that. You could tell one of these men or women or me that, and we'll pray over that. This is a church full of people who've messed up. You got a preacher who's got just when I look back on my past, I go, what were you thinking? So nobody's going to judge you here. We're going to love you. We are. It could be that once you heard that passage that I just read there about baptism, you're going, I never thought about baptism and the Spirit being connected. I think I want that gift. If you're ready to be baptized, later after our service this morning, Tyler Kelly's going to be baptized. We don't mind baptizing another one or 8 more or 80 more. If you want to be baptized, we'll be happy to do that. If you want to learn more about baptism, what I'm saying is that this morning there's a chance for you to talk to somebody and let God use these folks to speak into your life. We're going to sing a song. Let's go ahead and stand. We're going to sing a song. And I'm just hoping that you'll be caught up in the flow of the Spirit in your life and that you'll respond to that this morning. Let's pray and then we'll sing. God, I pray this morning for that soul in the room that is so burdened right now and so overwhelmed with sadness or with fear about the future or with regret about the past, that they will know that this is a place of safety and that they will respond to the promptings of your Spirit to seek out someone who can pray over them and love them in the midst of their struggle. I pray for any who are contemplating baptism this morning, Father, that they won't put that off another second, that they'll give their lives to Jesus in baptism this morning and receive the gift you give. I pray your Spirit will move through this room this morning and touch hearts and bless lives and lead people. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Turn my heart, O Lord, like rivers of water. Turn my heart, O Lord, by till my whole life flows in the river of your Spirit, and my name brings honor to the Lamb. Lord, I surrender to you.
Seated. Do we have any announcements that we need to make? Okay, a couple of announcements. This is not the end, okay? If you continue to need prayer and maybe you didn't feel comfortable going somewhere this morning, talk to one of these men or women around the room after our service this morning. Talk to me or Lincoln or Steve or Shelby. We'll be glad to pray with you, do whatever you need. Do not leave today with the thought in your heart that there's something you want to say or a move you want to make. Don't leave today without saying that word and making that move, all right? Lincoln's got a couple of announcements, then Bob Knoblich's going to lead us in the closing prayer.
We're glad that you were here. We're glad that the Spirit was here, amen? Bob's going to come and lead us in a word. As soon as I do, just a couple of things. One is, next week, the spring, is next Sunday night, and we will have the guys from The Way and Tom Reynolds here worshiping with us, so please make plans to be back on next Sunday night at 5 for the spring. Also, very sad to announce, the first preacher of this church was Bob Anderson. Bob has passed away several years ago. His wife, Jean, is still alive. Their grandson, Alex Anderson, passed away this week. The visitation for the family is 3 to 5, and the funeral at 5 o'clock on Wednesday, and both of those are at Laughlin. So please make a note of that and keep that family in your prayers this week. As always, we're glad that you were here. We hope that this morning has been meaningful. Bob, if you'll come and close as we stand for a closing prayer.
Let's pray together. Our God and Father in heaven, we come to you at this time to thank you for the blessings that you have provided for us. Lord, we recognize the power of your Spirit and are so thankful that it is with us today. As the all-powerful and knowing God, we thank you for the seasons that you have made. One season will soon be coming to an end and another beginning. Thank you, Lord, for this time of worship and the comfort that we know that you are with us. At this time, Lord, we are mindful of the children returning to school and the teachers who will be with them. Thank you for them and ask you to bless them as they begin this new school year. We ask you to comfort all of those who are ill, who are lonely, who are distressed in any way. Be with us as we begin this new week. Thank you for Jesus, in whose name we offer this prayer. Amen.